Good morning, challengers, and welcome to our final chapel of the 2019-2020 school year. It's hard to believe we are here. If you remember, I mentioned that in January, we stood in the chapel and we talked about how fast the year flies. And you laughed at me, but it does, doesn't it? It just flies right by. We are here in the family room at the church as we finish up our final chapel, and I'm excited to have this time down in this beautiful space to share with you. So why don't we start by praying, and then we'll dive into what God has for us today. Father God, I thank you for this time together. I ask that you will hide me behind your cross. May the words of my mouth be the words of your heart. Be with each of our students wherever they are, Lord, and draw them close to you as we learn and listen to what your word has to say to us today. Word of God, speak to us today. In your name we pray. Amen. Well, it is always a blessing to begin chapel with worship. So let's begin with a song today.
Miss Barbie, I'd be happy to kick off our final chapel time together. Ancient Words. How deep the Father's love for us.
Only
Thank you, Mrs. Benjamin. It's always a true blessing to be able to worship the Lord and sing with Him. Did you know that song? Maybe it was new to you. If not, I'm hoping that you sang along and enjoyed it. And if it was new, well, now you've learned another new song to honor God with. As we look back at this year, we reflect on what we've learned, which means we look back and we see what it is that we've learned, and we have learned so much as we've been discovering God's truth. It all begins with this book, the Bible. Early on, we began with the most basic question: is the Bible trustworthy? And we learned that it is trustworthy. We can rely on it. We can trust God's word and what it says. It's not just that the Bible tells us it's reliable, but time, history, and others have proven that also to be true. Other people have tested God's word and they have found it reliable. It has stood the test of testing by other people and the test of time. The Bible itself also tells us that it is trustworthy. We learn in 2 Timothy 3:16 that, remember our verse? All scripture is God-breathed and is useful for, say it with me, teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness, so that the servant of God may be thoroughly equipped for every good work. Do you remember when Pastor Dave joined us in chapel? He was talking to us and setting the stage for all that we were going to discover this year as we dove into God's word. Since we know that God's word is trustworthy, it makes sense to me, and maybe to you, that God's word is true. I know someone who loves the truth. Maybe this is a hint, and you know who it is too. He loves the truth as much, actually, he probably even loves it more than he loves basketball. Hey, Mr. Thies, can you tell us about the Bible and truth?
Sure, Miss Barbie. So, if the Bible is trustworthy, it's got to be true, right? You know, this reminds me of something. This reminds me of the 4th and 5th grade boys basketball team at ALCS this year. This team had an amazing season. I'm just gonna give a shout out to some of those kids. We've got Jared, we got Keenan, we got Derek, we got Mitchell, we got Jordan and Michard, and we got Nick, we got Carter, and we got Ben. This team went 15-1 this year. They finished the season, the regular season, they were undefeated. They won a tournament in the middle of the year, and they got second place at the end of the year. So I know you might be, if you weren't on that team, you might be thinking, prove it to me. How do we know that's true? How did we know that team was that good? What would you say if you were on the team, if someone asked you to prove it? Well, we got trophies, right? The team won 2 trophies this year. You could show them a trophy. That's pretty good proof. But you could also show them this. This is called a scorebook. This has every game written in there that they played this year, and the final score of the game, and how many points each player scored. Let's see, this was a game on January 11th against Madison Country Day School. Nicholas had 7 points. Jordan had 10 in that game. Let's go to a different game. We were playing St. Denis. This was a good game. ALCS won that game 40-6. Wow, they played well that game. Michard scored 2 baskets that game. Jared scored 3 baskets that game. Derek scored. Ben had 10 points in that game. So that was another good game. So we could always show them this scorebook. You know what? The Bible is a lot like this scorebook. The Bible was... parts of it were written by, do you guys know people like Peter and John and Matthew? Well, those guys were there and they wrote everything down. They actually saw Jesus walk on the water. They saw Jesus feed the 5,000. They were there when Jesus died on the cross. They actually saw the resurrected Jesus Christ. And then they wrote it all down and they wrote about their experiences. That's how we know that the Bible is true, because the people that were there actually wrote it down. They were eyewitnesses. So, the Bible is true. Did you catch that, Barbie?
Thank you. Caught it, Mr. Thies. Thanks so much. As we were discovering God's truth this year, we also focused on how the Bible is more than just a book. It's a map for our lives, a guide. Who do I know that could remind us of this truth? Oh, I know. Hold on. All right. Hey, Mrs. Hurl. Can you help me out?
Oh, it looks like I just got a text from Miss Barbie. Oh, how is the Bible a guide? That's a really good question, Miss Barbie. What should I tell her? Oh, I know. I think we could talk about Psalm 32:8. Psalm 32:8 says, I will instruct you and teach you in the way you should go. I will counsel you with my loving eye on you. Yeah, that's a good verse. Oh, how do I explain that to Miss Barbie? Well, if we look at the verse, it says, I will instruct you and teach you in the way you should go. That's being a guide. Yeah, that's what I'll tell Miss Barbie, that the Bible says that he'll teach us the way we should go. He'll guide us. But not only that, he says, I will counsel you with my loving eye on you. What does counsel mean, though? Oh, that means that he'll talk to us and help us decide, but he'll do it. I think the last part is so important, that he'll do it with love, because his loving eye is on us. Yeah, that's how the Bible is our guide. It instructs us, it teaches us in the way we should go, and it counsels us with his loving eye on us. Just like as a parent, I do with my kids. I help them because I love them. That's what God does. His word is a guide out of his love. Yep, that's the answer. That's what I'll tell Miss Barbie.
Thanks, Mrs. Hurl. That was a great reminder, R-E-M-I-N-D-E-R, of how God's word helps us. Oh, I hope you found that as helpful as I did. We find such wisdom in God's word. That's because it wasn't written by people. Well, I mean, they were people that wrote it. But the words came from God. It was inspired. Oh, what was inspired again? I think we need some help. Hey, Mrs. Walker, could you remind us what it means that God's word is inspired?
I'd love to, Miss Barbie. Often, athletes and coaches inspire each other through motivation, speeches, and things when they're playing games to get good athletics to happen. However, that type of inspire is not what the word means here. God's word is inspired because it comes from him. Even though we know that it's written by people with their pens and their pencils and their papers, the Holy Spirit was inside of them, guiding them what to say. God was speaking to them as they wrote, so that word came from him. It wasn't created by people. There's two verses that we have that kind of speak to this. The first is 2 Timothy 3:16. The verse says, all scripture is God-breathed and is useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness. Because it's God-breathed, that means that God gave breath to those words. He's the one who made them up. He's the one who decided how they would sound. He knew how they would speak to your heart. And he's the one that planned them. He used a person to write them down, just like he uses us now to reach other people and to share his word. But they're from him. 1 Thessalonians 2:13 says, and we also thank God continually, because when you receive the word of God, which you heard from us, you accepted it not as human word, but as it actually is, the word of God, which is indeed at work in who you believe. That word of God comes from God. He is the one who said those words and told the people. And the Holy Spirit living inside of you that can lead you to following God is that same spirit that helped the people who wrote the Bible know what God wanted them to say. And I heard that Mr. Thies reminded us all of how God's word is true, and that connects to how God's word is inspired. We can trust it, and I hope knowing this inspires you to read God's word every day. Think we can inspire our students to do that, Miss Barbie?
Thanks. I absolutely believe it. I appreciate it, Mrs. Walker. Knowing what we do about the Bible, it sure seems important for us to read it every day so that we can find what God has in it for us. God has made us for a purpose. His word helps us learn about that purpose. Now, I know just the person to remind us about purpose because she's a purpose person. So, give me 1 second. I'm going to make a quick call, and I'm going to ask our friend, Mrs. Pierce, for some help. Mrs. Pierce understands having a purpose. She always has a good reason for everything that she does, and I bet she can. Oh, hi, Mrs. Pierce. It's Miss Barbie.
Hi, Miss Barbie.
We're talking about God's word and how it provides purpose. I was wondering if you could explain how that is true for us.
Absolutely, I'd love to. Let me just put you on speaker real quick. God's word certainly does provide us purpose. God created each of us uniquely and has prepared us each with our own story. We need to use God's word to understand what our purpose is as God's people. I actually have 2 verses I'd like to share with you today. The first verse comes from Joshua chapter 1, verse 8. Keep this book of the law always on your lips. Meditate on it day and night so that you may be careful to do everything written in it. Then you will be prosperous and successful. God's word is a guide. It's kind of like a map of what we need to do. We must read and know God's word and follow what it says. The other verse I wanted to share is from Luke, chapter 11, verse 28. He replied, "Blessed rather are those who hear the word of God and obey it." This verse is a really good reminder of how we need to read and know God's word. But most importantly, we need to listen to it. We need to be an obedient follower of what God's word asks of us. We need to know scripture and equip ourselves with it. We can do this through reading our Bible or studying the Bible with fellow Christians. But one of my favorite ways to read the Bible and become familiar with scripture is through Bible journaling. I use my Bible that has bigger margins in it, and I draw myself pictures or highlight the verse in different fun colors or even write myself a note. That way, when I go back through my Bible, that verse really sticks out to me, and it reminds me of what God is instructing. The other way I really enjoy becoming familiar with scripture and reading it is through my daily devotions. I do my daily devotions every night before bed, and this is a great way for me to wind down my day and to fall asleep with God's word on my mind. Well, I'm so glad that you called, Miss Barbie. I love to talk about the Bible. I hope this helps everyone remember how reading the Bible will help them know what God has for them. I'll talk to you soon. Bye.
Thank you. Bye. That was so great to get a chance to talk to Mrs. Pierce. Oh, a life serving God and his purpose is a life well lived, my friends. We were also created for life here on earth, and God desires us to be with him in heaven as well. God's word gives life. What kind of life? Eternal life. You knew that before I even said it, didn't you? So who do I know that could help with this? That's one of the most important things we learn in the Bible, how to have eternal life with God. God's word gives life. What a beautiful thing. Beauty. Oh, what a beautiful thing. Our God is a God of love, beauty, justice, goodness. Well, the list goes on and on. Wherever I look, I see life. the life God has given. Wouldn't it be fun? Wouldn't it be fun if Mrs. Gabriels could be here and talk about life and beauty? You know, as an art teacher, she understands that so well. I wonder if she was here, what would she say? 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 Hello!
What would I say? I'd say that God is the author of all beauty, creativity, and love. God is good, so good that he made a way for all of us to be with him forever, forever. God is holy, and he can't have sin near him. As humans, we're sinful. Romans 3:23 says, "For all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God." Yet he loves us enough to provide a way to be with him forever. That way is through Jesus. Jesus was sinless, and he died for us so that we could choose to accept him as our Savior and ask forgiveness for our sins. We can go to heaven and be with God. What a beautiful gift What a beautiful gift of a loving and good God. God gives us life, and Jesus provides us an opportunity for eternal life if we choose to accept it. The Bible is all about life, and life abundant. Jesus tells us in John 10:10 that he has come that they might have life and they might have it abundantly. Jesus wants us to have life and to enjoy life and to have a life that is full, that is overflowing with goodness and love and joy and peace and patience, kindness, faithfulness. We are to have rich, beautiful lives. That's even where we get our name for our school, Abundant Life. How about that? Life is the gift Jesus brings to us, and we only need to accept it. Our lives are a beautiful reflection of Jesus. If we live for him, we can show others through our words and our actions the love of Jesus. Someone you know, someone I know, may be drawn to God because of how we live our lives. So, it's very important that we read God's word and learn how to live our lives for God, how to love others, and how to serve others like Jesus did. God's word gives life. It's all right there in the pages of the book. We just need to open it and read it to discover the beauty of the abundant life God has for us. That's what I'd say.
What'd she say? What would she say? Have you ever wondered what someone would say about something? You just need to ask. And the next time I see Mrs. G, I'm going to ask her what she'd say about God's word giving life. You know, I bet she'd have some really amazing words for us about that. I do know someone else who always has amazing words for us. Someone who wanted to make sure and pop by today and our final chapel of the year and share a really important fact about God's word. Hey, Pastor Dave.
Hi, Miss Barbie. Nice to see you. Sorry, just not playing with, but just looking at my son's sword here, and I'm enjoying it. I like the shininess of it. I like holding it. I like sharpening it. But I'll tell you, if anybody came up to me with a sword, I probably wouldn't know how to fight because I really wouldn't know what to do. I feel weak when someone else has a sword, but I feel strong when I have the sword. Well, Jesus talks about that with his disciples. He said, if you know my word, then you will know the truth. And in John 8, he says, the truth that is in my word is going to be the truth that sets you free. Free from what? Well, a lot of these disciples and a lot of us are really concerned about what other people think and what other people say. And we're always wondering, how do I compare? Am I good enough? Am I smart enough? Am I handsome enough? Am I pretty enough? I don't know. Do I have enough money? God doesn't concern himself with those things. And when we know the truth of who he says that we are and who he is and that we are his kids and his children and he loves us, well, then I don't need to be bound and frustrated and concerned about what everyone else is saying, because I know God's truth and what he says about me and who I am in him. And that sets me free from what any of those other people are saying. And in Ephesians chapter 6, it talks about putting on the armor of God. And one of my favorite parts of the armor of God is that God says, take up the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. I don't know about you, but my Bible has really thin pages. And so I don't think about those pages being like a sharp sword. But it's not just the pages. It's what's inside those pages. Those pages are filled with God's love, God's promises, and God's power, and his purpose, and his plan. So that is why Jesus says, take the sword of the Spirit and use it as a weapon as you fight in prayer. So when we pray, I don't want to think about, well, I don't know what I feel like. I want to pray about, what do I know and what has God promised me? Because when we know what God has promised us, we can pray the very things that he wants to do. And then finally, if I can share one more thing, Hebrews 4:12 talks about the word of God is alive and active, and it's sharper than any double-edged sword. So when I hold this sword, this is two edges on it. So no matter which way I strike, it's going to slice. And when we have the word of God in our hearts, it is sharper than a double-edged sword. And God's word will do what it sets out to do. God's promises are powerful, and his word is true, and it never fades away. We can count on God as we use his word as the sword of the Spirit, when we talk to others, when we remind ourselves of who God is, and when we pray against the enemy, we have all power, knowing that God's word is a sword in our hands and a weapon at our side. Well, I hope that helps. Thanks, Miss Barbie, for letting me check in. We'll see you guys later.
Thanks, Pastor Dave. Oh, he is such a good friend to us, and he really loves you all. Such wisdom he shared with us today. I'm so glad he could join us and talk about a crucial aspect of God's word. It's a sword to help us. So keep reading God's word and hiding his words in your heart. Memorize those Bible verses. They are so important in the fight. It is amazing, truly amazing, all the good we find between these pages. We've talked about so many wonderful aspects of the Bible today, but maybe my favorite one is this. God's word endures. Just like God is unchanging, his word is also unchanging. It is the same yesterday, today, and tomorrow. God's word is even the same in different languages. You could read the Bible in English or in Spanish or in French or any other language, and the meaning is the same. It endures in our hearts forever, regardless of how the language is. I know Mr. Staley could explain how God's word endures in any language. Good thing Mr. Staley is Zooming with us at chapel today. He can take it from here. Hey, Mr. Staley. Hola, Señor Staley. Did you hear that? Can you talk about how God's word endures?
Hola. I didn't, I can. We know that God's word, just like his love, endures forever. 1 John tells us that all things start with the word. For in the beginning there was the word, and the word was with God, and the word was God. He is inseparable from his word, and it is as everlasting as he is. And we know, as it says in Psalm 119, that all his words are true and his righteous laws are eternal. We know we can trust God's word. We know that it will endure. It is a lamp to light our paths. The things of this world may change and fade, but his truth does not. The good news has no expiration, and that is a reason to rejoice. Thanks for asking, Miss Barbie. Adios.
Gracias, Senior Staley. Thank you. Oh, what a great way to end our reflection on discovering God's truth this year in elementary chapel. What fun to have our specials teachers join us and help us out. I really appreciate that. And I hope you enjoyed hearing from them too. Plus, we had a visit from Pastor Dave. Good stuff as we wrap up our chapel for the year. That's for sure. So we have one more special guest to share with you. But before we get there, I want to just remind you that you can always worship the Lord. You can sing in the car. You can sing in the shower. You can sing outside. You can sing before you go to bed. You can sing in your head. You can sing out loud. But take the time every day to worship the Lord. You can worship him as you read your Bible. You can worship him as you pray. But don't forget throughout the summer to take the time, not just on Sundays, but take the time every day to give the Lord, to give our Lord the worship he is due. He's worthy of it.
Hey guys, my name is Ashlyn. Some of you may recognize me, some of you may not. But I'm the guy who's typically been doing the videos for your chapel. And as we were filming for this specific chapel, Miss Barbie had mentioned that she wanted to do this song, but because of a whole bunch of boring things that would probably put you guys to sleep, we can't actually use that video. And so I figured that I would do it for her. And so here's Word of God Speak. I was told that you guys have been doing this all year. So we are going to go ahead and do that song. God, I'm so thankful that your word speaks to us, God. And I pray that as we head into the summer, God, that your word would continue to speak to us. In your name, amen.
So, let's get to our final guest. I've asked someone very special to all of us to come and close out this year's chapel. I've asked someone very special to all of us to come and close out this year's chapel. We don't often see him at elementary chapel, but that's because he's busy working. But he made the time to come and join us today. I've invited Mr. Butler to come and close our chapel for this year. So would you please fold your hands and close your eyes, and let's join Mr. Butler in prayer.
All right. Thank you, students. Let's pray. Father God, we acknowledge you as the source of all truth and the giver of all life. And we thank you for the opportunity that we have had to learn about you through all of our chapel services this year. We pray that those truths that have been planted in their hearts would bear fruit. And we pray that you would draw them to you this summer, that they would continue to learn your truth, that they would continue to worship you with all their heart and all their soul and all their mind and all their strength, Lord. Help them to grow in not only knowing your truth, but applying it to their lives and helping to make godly decisions. So we commit all of our elementary students into your hand over these coming months this summer. Ask for your hand of protection and blessing on them. We pray it all in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you so much, Mr. Butler. We appreciate you closing us out. That's it, guys. Another year of chapel has come to an end. Have a great day and keep discovering God's truth. Bye.